Hi, welcome to Knitwell Motorhomes. I'm Andy, and today we're going to do something a little bit different for you. We're going to do a handover stroke walk around video on this WildAx Solaris XL. I really hope you find it informative. So what we're going to do is we're going to do an external walk around first of all and show you all the bits and pieces on the outside. So the first thing, if we want to get underneath our bonnet release catch is just here. Here we have our fuel. Now that works after your ignition key. And then of course we have our AdBlue underneath. Now with the later vehicles on the Fiat Ducato, you can tell how much AdBlue you have in your system. We'll go into that when we go into the cab. We have the awning just above and the awning light. We'll go into your awning in more detail in a little while. When we open up the habitation door, you'll see we have a full length fly screen just here. And of course we have the electric habitation step. The button just there, press that, out it pops. As we're walking round, here we have the gas barbecue point. So that will work off the gas in your system. At the back, you'll see we have a reversing camera at the top. And we also have reversing sensors, which are based into the bumper, just here. While we're at the back, we're going to open up. Now you'll see these black buttons on either side of the doors. That's because they lock in this position, but if we press that, we can actually take the door right the way round. Same on this side as well. So press that, slide it round. Now you'll also see here you have your awning brace, and here, this is where we have your cassette toilet. Now, anybody new to motorhoming, we'll go into this again when we go into the bathroom, but on your toilet there's a handle to open and close the blade. The blade must be sealed for you to be able to take the cassette out for obvious reasons. And what you do is there's a little green catch just there. So we push that up and we slide it out. Now on this one, you have a little button there, slides up and it's like an airport carry case. You then wheel that to your Alson point. Now every campsite should have an Alson point and that's where you dispose of your waste. And you literally take the cap off, you press the green button on the back, because what that will do is that will allow air to flow through, so it's not going to glug as it's coming out, it's going to run out smoothly. So you flush away, hose through, flush away again, put your new chemical directly into the cassette. You don't want to be putting it down the toilet because it's very strong and it will stain. Little bit of water, and then you pop that back into there. It's not the horrible job that people think it's going to be. Now, while we're talking toilets, we'll talk toilet paper as well. There's obviously what you don't want to be doing is using like triple quilted toilet paper. The chemicals are very strong, but it will struggle to break that down. So use proper camping toilet paper or cheaper toilet paper. Now, just here, we have access. If we push these in, if I can, there we go, there's one. This one's a bit stiff. And two. Now that actually gives us access so we can go into the bathroom. Really, it's more of a point that if you needed to get out in a hurry, you can get through from this way. But again, it's nice because if you've got long loads, you can slide them through. Right, so we'll shut this up. And we'll carry on round. Electric hookup point, just here. And underneath the vehicle, we do have a proper spare wheel. As we're walking round, your fresh filler point just there. Now, when it comes to water, you can't overfill your system. You pop the hose in and you fill it up. You'll know when it's full, it'll pour out all over your feet. Fridge vents here and here. Flue for your heating just there. And then underneath, you'll see we have these two taps. Grey water, fresh water. Now, with these taps, there is a way to actually do them. You hold the tap before you turn. Otherwise, over a period of time, you can loosen the pipe. The last thing you want is that falling off as you're driving down the motorway. Same scenario on the fresh as well. And then we have, on this particular van, an underslung LPG gas tank. Now, We will go into this in more detail in a moment, but for anyone who hasn't used one before, it just means you're taking less storage out of the van. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail underneath the bonnet, but there are certain things that it's advantageous to know, such as just here, this is your washer bottle fluid. Now, it is quite down low, but if you slide out, again, it makes it easier for access. Now, as for the rest of your fluids, they're here, so you do have to undo these catches and take this piece off to gain access. Don't worry about dipsticks. That is done now on the dash, which we'll show you when we go into the cab. The real reason I want to show you underneath here, though, is quite simple. If you have a flat battery, the battery is underneath the floor pan, underneath the passenger side, and there's a big plastic cover on it, and it's a nightmare to get to. So if you do have a flat battery and you do want to jump the vehicle, the easy way is your negative just sits on there. And just down here, there is a catch. And if we pop that up, that is your positive. So again, negative, positive, on there, you jump from underneath here, it will save you cutting your fingers to pieces. So, your underslung gas tank. Well, I'm a great believer in the underslung tank. I really think it's a great idea. Now, how you use it is you'll see there are two pins just there. So, when you go to fill up, and like I said, there's usually a couple of places in every town or city that will do LPG, but check before you get there, because they do it, it doesn't mean they've always got it. So you do have to make sure they've actually physically got it before you travel. Now, it's a bit like filling up with diesel. On the two pins, what you would do is you have a pump that fits onto there and it will lock. Then underneath there is usually a bar, and that is your seal. Once you've sealed it, you'll press a button. It's usually red for some bizarre reason, which you would think it wouldn't be, but you will press that and that will fill your tank. Now, it works very, very much the same as like with your diesel or your petrol. When the tank is full, it stops. If it is a 25 litre tank, it will give you 20 litres of gas and then leave you 5 litres for expansion. Now, if you've never done this before, where it will catch you slightly is when you come to release the bar with the pressure, because what will happen is there'll still be some gas left in the pipe. Now, you'll usually find there's a big shield on that, and the reason is to stop you from getting your hands above, because when you release the pressure, there's some left in there and the gas goes boom, and it will frighten the life out of you. But it is so cold that it will burn if it gets you, so you've got to keep your hand on this side of the shield. Don't put it above or you will end up freezing your hand and burning it. Now, once you've done that, you unclip, you pop it back in, job done. It's a really nice, easy system to use. And the beauty is it costs you a lot less than paying for your calor bottles, because you're not paying for hire. Also, on the continent, everywhere tends to be LPG filling. But what you will need are Euro adapters. And you can see you have threads in there, because for different countries, you can screw in the adapter for that country. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to have a look underneath in a second, where I will show you the tank itself. But before we do that, how much do we know when we got in our system? Well, that's quite simple. Just here, you have some LED lights, and depending on how many of those are up, will depend on how much gas you have in your system. So here, we have your underslung gas tank. And under here, we have your valve. So if we unclip this, be careful when you get it back on properly, because if that drops off, it can shatter. You have a valve here. So if you needed to completely turn your gas off because you weren't working from the isolators, this is where you would do it from. Now, where gas is concerned, it's quite simple. Don't try and regulate it yourself. It's either fully turned on or it is fully turned off. So again, if you were on the ferry or something, you might need to turn this off. But apart from that, most people tend to work it from the isolators. But again, check with your manufacturer before you obviously decide what you're going to do on that one. But like I say, there is your valve. So you would turn that fully on or fully off. That goes back on. And there you go. So next we're going to do your awning. Now, the first thing, and probably one of the most important things, is to make sure this door is closed. Otherwise, when you start to wind it out, that will drop behind the door and you can end up damaging your awning. Next thing is the handle on your awning is adjustable. So we can loosen that off. So if you're short like me, you can adjust the size and then you can just tighten it up into the right position. Helps if you go the right way. There we go. Now, you will see on the end of the awning brace, you have two pins just here, and they will lock in to the two pins on the awning itself. Now, technically, this should be a two-person job, because you really want to get to about halfway down and then drop the legs, and it's always easier if somebody can take the weight. Myself being 5'6", that's not necessarily that easy, especially if you're traveling on your own. But what we want to do is we want to slide this out. So you just wind out. Now, like I say, far easier as a two-person operation. And if you were doing it purely by the letter of the law, you want to get to about halfway, drop the legs an inch out. But as I said, I just can't reach it at that point. Now, we're not going to take it the whole way out. We'll take it to around about there. There we go, we'll leave that there for a second. Now, when we look inside, you'll see that the legs are spring-loaded in. So we just push it back and then we can drop it down. And then we have these clips. Now, we want to get this to size. So you put it into a position and then you push these clips up. Now, when they're new, they're quite stiff and it'll feel like it doesn't want to go. It will, and the more you use them, the easier it'll become. We'll do the same on the other side. So again, that just slots down, push that up. They are quite stiff, like I say, when they're new. We just get that to position and we lock it in place. Now, the most important thing with any awning is, if the weather is very bad, you can put storm straps on, but really it is a sunshade. If it's awful weather, get it in. It's quite easy for this thing to literally rip up, end up on your roof and damage your roof, or again your skylights, and you could be talking a lot of money to put that right. So when we're putting it back in again, we just literally drop that clip there, slide it down into that position, bring this back up, you push back so it locks into place. Same on the opposite side, again, clip down, slide the leg up, and we're going to slide that back in like so. And then we wind it back in. Now make sure it's all the way in, else otherwise again you can be causing yourself an issue for further on down the line. So that just winds back up into place. In the cab, what can we tell you? Well, the first thing, of course, is you have full blinds. Now, with these, you pinch. The temptation is to try and bring that down. Keep it straight. That literally just goes onto there on a magnet. Now, when you bring them back, you slide, you get the last piece in, you tuck in, and it clips in nice and easily. With the front, again, you pinch and you slide to the center. Now, again, this works on a magnet, and it does seal down the center. One thing that I would always recommend is put an elastic band or something over there. Reason being is, it is a strong magnet, but if you don't get it quite right, because you've turned up late of the night, you're walking around in the morning, and that can happen. And that can be pretty embarrassing. An elastic band can save you an awful lot of embarrassment in that respect. Now, again, make sure you clip them back in properly, because the last thing you want to be doing is turning it around a corner and that pops out in front of your face. So as for the rest, what we can say, well, again, we have our electric mirrors just here, and they work like on a joystick. So you have two mirrors either side. So you have your main mirror and you have your blind spot one at the bottom. So you just then left, right, up and down. Make sure when you've done each one that you just click it back into the center when you're done. So if you touch it by accident, you're not going to adjust your mirrors. Electric windows here, and that there allows you to lock or unlock your doors. Just here, you will see, now that is the gauge for your gas in your system. We will go into gas in more detail in a little while. We have your auto stop start down there, but really what I want to concentrate on is these controls on here. Now, here we have your cruise control. But for these over here, this gives us a lot more information now, which I'm going to pop the key in so I can show you. So, where we have it saying Fiat just here, this is going to give us more info. I'm going to turn the stereo off for a second because we don't need that. So, as you can see at the moment, we're on vehicle setup. It says press OK to enter. Now, that will give us the ability to change kilometres to miles, miles per hour to kilometres per hour. But by using these controls just here, we can control what information we have up. So if we press the down button, you'll see now we've got a big speedo, but there's all these dots at the top. Now that's because if we go back through, we can have our trip computers. So we've got trip B there, trip A, and we have our instant info, which will give you your range and your current fuel consumption. We go down to the next one, and again, it will tell us our miles per gallon. Next one will then give us our oil temperature. But again, if you can see, we have these dots at the top. So we go back to the first one. First of all, we have our oil level. Then we have our oil temperature. Then we have our oil life. The battery charge, and that's for the vehicle battery. Your AdBlue, so again, very much like with your fuel, you can see how much AdBlue you have in your system. Go over. Service light, that's a little bit deceiving because that's for a Fiat Ducato. Obviously, with a motorhome as of today, it is 2 years or 20,000 miles, whatever comes sooner, that you need to have the Fiat Ducato serviced. And then we come back round to oil. We go down again and we go to alerts. So again, if there's something going on in your system that you need to know about, it'll pop up there and it'll tell you what it is. And then we go back to setup. So again, this is great because it gives you all the information that you really need to see just there. So the next thing, of course, is we have climate control instead of air conditioning. So again, we can set the temperature that we want. Also with the fan speed, just there. And at the moment, 26 degrees. Again, it's just more confirmed. We'll knock that off, so you're not guessing at what the heat will be. Then we have your media center. So with your media center, as you can see, we've got the home button there. It is a DAB unit and it's also Bluetooth. It's got a very nice sound on it as well. I'm not going to go into too much detail. I don't want to spoil the fun of having a play with something when you first buy it. Now, what is interesting though on the Fiat Ducatos is that if you have your air conditioning on, over here at the back, you'll see there is a grid. And that means that the cool air comes out into here. So it works a little bit like a mini fridge. So if you've got a bar of chocolate or water, a little bottle of water, it's great because it keeps it nice and cool. Of course, down here we have two large cup holders and the seats are all fully adjustable. Now, if we want to spin them, there's a catch just here and we pull that back and then you shift your bum across. Now, they are quite stiff when they're new and then you have the backwards and forwards underneath. Now, I'm going to spin this because what I do want to show you is on the side of the seat. Now, just here we have these two catches and that's to raise or lower the seats. Now, it works on a rocker system. So the front one will do the front of the seat and the back one will do the back of the seat. So again, you can get into the perfect position. You also have the wheel there, again, for the backrests. And of course, even the armrests are adjustable. So you've got the wheel there so you can get those into the right position. Now, the seat will only lock in one position and that is your driver position. When you hear the clunk, that goes back straight, you know you're locked in. And there's your cab. Now, in the lounge, we have the ability to put up two small tables and you can use one of those tables also between the driver's seat and the passenger seat if you just want to use it as a coffee table. You'd use the two to make the two small tables into a large table for when you're dining. Now, how you do that is the two table legs are in this wardrobe just at the back. So we'll take one out. Now, in the floor, you can see we have these caps. We take one out like so. And then that locks in. Once you've done that, just tighten it up. That way it makes it rigid so it's not going to move about. Then you have a tabletop behind this seat and another one behind this seat. And we just unclip and that sits on there. The same will happen with the one in front. Now, obviously, as you can see, this is a seat at the moment, but we can make that up into a seat the same, so you don't need to be seeing your tabletops. It's just we've made this one into a settee. Beds in the Solaris XL. Well, to start off with, of course, we have your two bunks at the rear. Now, if you have got children in, you've got this netting at the top, which will lock into the roof, again, to stop them rolling out. There is the ladder, of course, to get to the top bunk. Again, down below, it's nice that you've got storage lockers on either one. And of course, you do have these quite deep drawers underneath. Now, as for the front, because this is a genuine four berth for travel. So this one, as you can see at the moment, we've got made up into the settee. Now you can do this on either side because this has got a boarding on the back and that's because it becomes the center of your bed as well. Now, to start off with, as you can see, this is quite upright because it's in a driving position, but you've got the catch here. Now, if we want to bring it out just one slot, then it makes the seat tilt back slightly. So again, it's just more comfortable if you're sat around, especially if you've got the driver's seat and the passenger seat swiveled and you've got four people sitting around having a drink. But we want to make this into the bed. So what we're going to do is we're going to pull it out completely. So that will then slide down. That then pops into there. Now, obviously, as we've said, we've already done this side, but there is a H-bracket that just fits across here, so that will give you your strength here. Now, apart from that, you've got these runners down this side, and what happens is you literally take this piece, and like I say, it's got the backboarding on, and that just fits down the center. So if we imagine the H-bracket is there, this then fits into there. You've got a transverse double at the front, you've got the two singles at the back. There you've got your four berths. So now we're going to talk about your kitchen in the Solaris XL. Now, as you can see, we have your sink here, your mixer tap, which we'll move across. Ironically, what's quite rare for a van conversion is we do have a full oven. You have four gas hobs, you have separate grill, and of course, the oven underneath. You have got good work surface space as well, which again is quite rare in a van conversion. Down here, we have the four drawers. So again, excellent storage. We have a small storage locker over here as well. And you'll see in there, you've got the plug for your microwave. Now again, your microwave will only work if you're plugged into the mains because it needs to run on 230 volt. Then we have your fridge. So as you can see, freezer compartment at the top. They say this is for salad, beer and wine, absolutely perfect. So how does your fridge work? Well, this is a three-way fridge freezer. So to turn it on, we press that button there. Now, the beauty with a three-way is, unless you're going over on the ferry or something and you have to physically turn it off, there should always be a source for you to be able to use. So that button there will give us auto, but we're going to pretend auto doesn't exist at the moment. Then we have electric, we have battery, and we have gas. Right, let's say you're going away. So tomorrow you're down in Dover and you're after Southampton. So the night before you've got the van at home, you're gonna fill it up with the bits and pieces. So you've got it plugged into the mains at home. That's great. In that respect, we would then have that on electric. It's flashing at us because it's telling us you can't do that because we're not plugged into the mains, but don't worry about that. We'd have it on electric and we would get it to temperature. And that's great, we will pack up all our stuff. Now, when we come to leave, of course, we have to then unplug. Once we do that, it's gonna start doing what it's doing now. It's gonna start flashing at us and saying, well, you can't do that, I've got no power. So then you would start up your engine. Once you've started up your engine, you would go to battery. Now, one of the great misconceptions with motorhomes is that battery means leisure battery on your fridge. It doesn't, it is vehicle battery, which means the engine must be running. And that will then stay running for as long as you have the engine running. As soon as you turn the engine off, it will stop. So we've packed up our van, we've put it onto battery, and off we go. And we've traveled right the way up to Newcastle. And you're tired, you want to pull in at the services. As soon as you turn off the engine, as we said, this is going to happen. Now, if you only stop in 5 minutes, you have a cup of coffee and a wee, that's absolutely fine because you'll get back in, you'll start it up, it's not an issue. But if you were going to stop and have a meal or something, well, you can't plug it into the mains. And you can't leave the engine running. So that's when you would turn on your gas. Once you've turned on your gas, you will then flick that across to gas and it will run off your gas. You come back out after having your meal, you want to set off again, so that's fine. You turn on your engine, you turned off your gas when you're traveling, you then bring that back round and we would then put that back to battery while we were traveling and away you go. You get to your site in Scotland. Next thing you do is you plug it in the mains and then you would put it on for electric. Now, of course, we do have an auto setting on here. Now, auto should do all these things for you. I say should because it will do what it thinks is right, which is not necessarily what you think is right. So it's always advisable to check every now and again, press the button, what are you doing? Now, also you'll see over here, we have the controls just here, and that is for how cold you have your fridge. Now, depending on the time of year and depending on how hot it is outside, would really depend on how cold you have that. The other thing is, as you can see just here, we have a blue light. Blue's good. If we turn that off, that will knock off everything. Light goes off. If there is something going on that it doesn't like, that will turn red. The other thing to bear in mind with your fridge is quite simple. When you've been using your fridge, make sure you leave it open afterwards. The reason being is if you've turned it off, you go away, it cools down, it gets warm. The next time you go in there, that's as moldy as you can leave. It really is. So make sure you've left this door open, wipe it down when you're done, and you won't have an issue. So that's your fridge. We've done your microwave. There's one other thing to show you, which is very important in your kitchen. Now, because you have a gas tank underneath, we need to know where our gas isolators are. Now, just at the back of here, there's a little cover. So if we pop that down, you will see you've got your isolators for each piece of gas equipment. Now, obviously, when you're traveling, you want all those knocked off anyway. But the beauty with that system is, let's say you were away in France and you had a gas leak on your hobs. You could isolate your hobs, which means you could still use your other gas appliances. Also, with this being an NCC van, you will see that we have gas drop holes underneath all your gas appliances. So if you were unlucky enough to have a gas leak, the gas is just going to drop straight down, because gas is heavier than air. It's going to drop out of the vehicle and it's going to disperse underneath. So next we have your bathroom in the Solaris XL. So as you can see, it fits across the back of the van. Now, you have storage just here. We have a mirror behind, towel hook, or for your clothes just there. Another towel rail just there, and of course your toilet rail there. Wash basin and your shower. And again, another bath hanging. Now with your toilet itself, as you can see, first of all, you can move it around so you can get into the most comfortable position. But the thing that's most important down here is, as you can see at the moment, the blade is across. Now that allowed us to be able to take the cassette toilet out earlier. Unless that blade is in that position, you cannot take out your cassette. But when you're using it, you have a handle just here. So this grey handle we would now pull out. That opens up your cassette. The only reason that you want that open is if you're using it. Apart from that, keep it closed to stop any smells or anything else coming back up into the van. So once you've used it, pop it back across and you're done. And that is your bathroom. So here we have our 12 volt control panel. This switch here turns it on and off, and that one will give us our 12 volt power. Now, as you can see, the lights have come on when we've turned that on. Water pump, as we've said before, our awning light, lights. Down here, that will turn the whole thing off. Program, so you can program it in. And then here, of course, it will show you your fresh water tank and how much water you've actually got in there. And then this one will show you with your batteries. So again, your vehicle battery and your leisure battery, it's showing you how much you've got in both, and also with your solar. Windows and skylights. Now, with your windows, the first thing is, as you can see with this one, you've got these little buttons on the catches. So you need to press those, not on that one, as you can see, that one's already done, and the little button on there. And then you can slide those out. Now they're on stays, which will click into place. So if you want to drop it back down, put it right the way up and drop it. Lock it in. Obviously, when you're traveling, these windows do need to be closed, the same as your skylights, because they are plastic. If they catch the wind, they're gone. They are double glazed. So again, they retain the heat very well. They've also got like a privacy shield on them. So again, people can't really see them very easily from the outside, but also it stops the sun from penetrating too much. So it stops it getting too hot. We have our full blind at the top, we have our fly screen at the bottom, or you can have half and half depending on what you choose. The most important thing with these type of concertina blinds is quite simple though. A lot of people, when they're not using the van, will leave it like that and they will close all their blinds. Now there's a couple of reasons why that's not such a good idea. The first one is quite simple. A lot of people will say, we do it so people can't see in the van to see if there's anything worth stealing. Well, I suppose the other way to look at that is, if you pulled them down, people who would be looking to steal out your van will think, what are you hiding? It's worth breaking into that one. There's obviously something worth stealing. But the main reason is, these, as you can see, are a concertina. Now, If they're left in this position for a long period of time, I'm not talking about a week while you're away, I'm talking about 6 months over the winter, that will lose all its rigidity. And what will happen is when you come to shut that up, that will literally go bleh, and it will just sort of flop away, because you need to keep this nice and tight. And by keeping them up when you're not using them or down, it will stop that from happening. Same with your skylights. So again, if we look at this skylight just here, this one, you have a push button and you can slide up, and you've got two catches, so you can have it open depending on how much you want in. Again, when you are traveling, make sure they are closed. If that catches the wind, they're gone. And we've all probably seen 4 or 5 miles away from the campsite where you'll find a skylight. That's because of that reason. It's been left open when you're traveling. Same scenario, of course, though, that you have your blackout blind there and your fly screen. Now, this window is slightly different in the fact of that we have a catch just here, and that's a slider. Now, this is great, because what you don't want is, because you have a sliding door on the outside, is that going out? Because if it does, when you slide the door across, it's going to crack your window. Having this one across, it means you can open up your habitation door and you're not going to do any damage. So under this seat, we've got quite a lot going on, because we've got your leisure battery just here. We also have your battery charger. We have your trip switches just in here. There you go. And of course, we have your fuses just there as well. So again, be careful if you're storing anything in here. You don't want too much in there, because there's a lot going on. So now we're going to talk about water, with priming your system and draining your system down. Now, realistically, unless something's gone catastrophically wrong, there is only three reasons why water can be pouring out of your van. One, that you've opened up your fresh water tank. Two, that you've opened up your wastewater tank. Or three, that your boiler is open. And depending on what you're doing and at what stage, that should be self-explanatory. So what we're going to do to start off is we're going to go through priming your system. So the first thing we would do is we will pop the hose into the fresh water tank, as we saw outside, and you will fill. Now, at that point, if water is pouring out of your van, it means your fresh water tank's open. Go round to the taps on the opposite side, seal it. Once you've filled it up, the next thing we need to do is prime our system. So when we're priming our system, what we would want to do is we'd want to turn on the tap in the kitchen and also in the bathroom, and we want them on hot. The reason why we want them on hot is we're going to be filling the water in our boiler, and we need to be expelling the air, else otherwise you can get an airlock. It will think that the system is full when it's not. So we would open that up and we would do the same out there. Don't need to do it at the moment because we haven't got any water in, but the next thing we would do then is we'd come to our control panel. And just here, we have there the water pump. Now, when I turn it on, you can hear like a brrrr noise. And the reason for that is it will then be taking the water from your fresh water tank and it will be filling up your boiler. And you will hear that brrrr for a while. Now, what will happen is once it starts running through, this is going to start to cough and splutter, and then the water is going to start coming through in here and in the bathroom. Now, when it starts to run through smoothly, knock your taps off, but wait for the brrrr to finish, because that is filling up your boiler. Now, once your boiler is full, you have two options. Now, this depends on what you're doing and how you plan to do it. If you're on a site, you can leave it. It's not a problem. Every time you come back and put your tap on, the water will come out, because the water pump will kick in if it drops below the level. But if you're wild camping, you probably want to knock off the pump, purely for the reason being is if it's on standby, it's draining power. And if you're wild camping, the more things you've got draining power at your system, the quicker your batteries are going to go down. Now, I want to take a step back. We've put on our water pump and we can hear the brrring noise. Now, if water doesn't start coming out your tap, but water starts pouring out underneath the van, that means your boiler's open. So if we want to seal our boiler, what do we do? Well, underneath this seat, just here, you will see we have your boiler. Now, just down here, there is a tap. Now, as you can see, it's up in the air, this little yellow switch. Now, that means it's open. So if we did have any water in our system and we want to start pouring through, the water's going to come from the fresh into the boiler and pour straight down on the floor. So all we need to do is flick that switch. What then will happen is the water will go back into the boiler, it will fill, and then it will come through the taps. But what is very important is, especially during the winter months, that you flick this switch open when you're not using the van. The last thing you want is water left in your boiler when you've got freezing temperatures, because you will end up damaging your boiler. So once we've done that, the next thing, of course, is water's running through, no problem at all. Now, this is the third reason why water can be pouring out your van, because if water's now pouring out, it means your wastewater tank is open. So again, you just need to go over and seal that. Once you've done that, you have primed your system. Now, when it comes to draining your system down, we're doing basically the same thing, but in reverse. So what we would do is we would go outside and we'd open up our fresh water tanks and our wastewater just with the two taps and drain them down. The next thing we'd do is we'd go back to that switch on the boiler and we'll flick it up so it drains the water down in the boiler. Now, if you're doing this properly, you don't want to leave any water in your pipes. Now, I would usually say don't put your water pump on if you've got no water in your system, but open up your taps and just for about 10 or 15 seconds, pop the water pump on. So any water that's left in those pipes is going to get sucked through your tap and straight down into your wastewater tank, which is already open. And there we have it. That's how you drain your system down and you prime it. So next we're going to come to your heating, which is a Truma gas and electric system. So gas, again, you can use whenever. Electric, you can only use when you're plugged into the mains. So how it works, we press the button and we turn it on. Now, where Truma have probably got this slightly wrong is you've got these four icons across the top, because we need to use the third icon first, because that will give us our heat source. So once we press on there, you have a choice: gas, mix one, mix two, electric one, or electric two. So gas, well, that's quite self-explanatory, it's gas. Electric one is one electric element. Electric two is two electric elements. Now you're probably thinking, well, two is obviously going to get me up to heat quicker than one will, and that's absolutely correct. But it depends on where you are and how much electric current they've got coming into the van. You might find it's not that strong and it might trip out your system if you go to two. If it does, it's not an issue. It'll either trip on the post or it'll trip with your trips. You just flick it back and put it to electric one. Now, the other thing of where you could have an issue with this might be that you could be on a site and there could be you and a couple of other people there. The next day, 500 caravans turn up. Now, you might have got away with electric two the day before. You might not on that day. So it's just something to bear in mind. And of course, like I say, you can only use the electric if you are plugged in. So the first thing we find is, like I say, we have our heat source. Gas, mix one, mix two, electric one, electric two. Electric, as we've been through. Mix, now that is gas and electric. So again, mix one is gas in one electric element. Mix two is gas in two electric elements. Now, you will find that gas gets you up to temperature quicker than electric. So if you were to go away, say, in January and it was very cold, you might want to put it, as long as you're plugged in, put it on both, get up to heat, and then flick over onto the electric so you're not using your gas. Because the electric will hold it very easily, but it does struggle a little more to get you to temperature. So once we've set our heat source, the next thing we'll do is come back to the first icon. And that will give us our temperature of our heating. And that there then is anywhere up to 30 degrees. Now, once we've got that, again, it is thermostatically controlled. So it will only kick in if it drops below that temperature. So again, if you do want to go off for the day, for argument's sake, if you were going away in January and it was very cold, you'd get to the site, you'd set your heating, and you might set it at 10 degrees. That way it'll only kick in if it drops below, but it will mean that the van doesn't get freezing cold while you're away, and it will only kick in if it drops below that point. The next one we have is water. Now, I can't stress highly enough that the boiler must be full before you try to heat the water. Otherwise, you're trying to heat water that isn't there and it'll end up blowing your thermostat. But all we need to do is press onto the icon, which is number two, and you have a choice of eco, which is 40 degrees, hot, which is 60 degrees, or boost. One of you has just had a shower and the other one wants to have a shower quite soon after. You'd pop that on boost, it will just heat that water far quicker. Now, when we look at the fan, we have a choice. You have vent, which is just here, and vent, that will go from 1 to 10. Now, if you just want to circulate air around in your van, you can. And again, if it's 40 degrees outside, it's only going to circulate 40 degree air, but it can give you a bit of respite. Now, we haven't got this plugged in at the moment, but if we did, I'm going to pop this over And if we had the heating on and we come over to the fan, it will now give us a choice of eco or high. And what that's doing is, again, it then gives us a choice of how much air you're pushing through your system, either eco, which is low, or high, as it's pushing out more air. So this is where, again, we have these four icons, and it really works 3, 1, 4, 2. First of all, set your heat source. Secondly, set your temperature. Then set your fans, and then do your water. And again, make sure you have your water systems full. Now, we're going to scroll down to these bottom icons now. The first one is a timer. So again, if you get up at, say, it's going back, wasn't it? There we go. It's the timer. So for argument's sake, if you get up at 7 o'clock in the morning, you can set your heating to come on at 6, so it's lovely and warm. Next one is your clock. So you just press on there. We can change our time. And just scroll around, and then you press the button when you're happy. And then we come to the settings. So with the settings, the first thing you can do is offset the screen. For why you would want to offset the screen, I really couldn't tell you. I've never seen one that comes out of system, but again, you can do it. Temperature from degrees to Fahrenheit, the brightness of the panel, 12 or 24 hour clock. If this is all a little too easy and you want to do it in French, German or Italian, change the language, fill your boots. Index, I'll come back to in a second. And reset. So if you pick up a glitch in the system, you may want to do a factory reset, which that will do. So, index. If we do something wrong, or if there's a problem with the system, you will get a warning triangle come up just here. Now, I may be able to fool the system. Let's have a look and see if I can. We're not plugged into the mains at the moment, so I'm going to put that onto electric 2, and I'm going to turn the temperature on. We'll put that to a really cozy 30 degrees. Now, what will happen is it will try to actually click on with electric, and it will tell us that that's not possible. Now, it can sometimes take a couple of minutes for that to go through, but what will happen is we will have a warning triangle come up. Once we've gone onto that warning triangle, it will then tell us a code. Now, that code, if we go to a Truma technician, they could tell us what that means. The idea basically is that they may be able to sort the issue before you've even taken it in. There you go. As you can see now, warning triangles come up with the code. Now, those codes will be stored within the index. So again, you can find out what's going on. Now, on this position, we know exactly what's going on. We've put our heat onto electric, and we have no electric coming into the van. So that will stay up. Now, the one thing you do have to be careful of, and this is why I go back to the issue with making sure that you've got it plugged in before you try to put the heat source on or turn your gas on before you've actually put it on for gas. If you get that wrong and it locks you out, it can lock you out for up to 15 minutes as a safety precaution. And if you're going away in January or February, it can get pretty cold in 15 minutes. But there's your heating in your hot water system. So there you have it. There's our walk around handover on the Solaris XL. Now, it was on the Solaris XL, but you'll find that this will be basically the same for most WildAxes of the same sort of age. I really hope you've enjoyed it, and I hope you found it informative. If you have, great. Why don't you subscribe to our channel? There's a button just down here in one of these corners, got the little Nick Whale sign on it. Press on that, and that will get you subscribed, and you can watch all of the content that you can see. Now, if you do decide to buy a van from us in the future, don't worry, it's not me that's going to be doing your handover with you. It'll be the technician who works on your van, who's obviously far more technically knowledgeable than I am. But again, really hope you've enjoyed the video.